In this video, I would like to tell something about visualization, which is, in my opinion, a very important part of scientific writing, especially in the technical and in the engineering sciences. You all know the saying, a picture says a thousand words. And another motivation to think about this topic is, if you read a paper or if you read a report or a thesis, and if you don't have much time, what you do is you skip through the pages and you look at the figures and the diagrams and you maybe read the captions. And then you try to get a clue what the thesis or what the report is about. And then if you think it's interesting, then you read the introduction and maybe the summary. And after that, you will read the text. And to be honest, I think this is also what your supervisors and your professors who are grading your work sometimes do. If they don't have much time, they will skip through your report or paper and look at the figures and the diagrams at first. And try to get an idea about your work. So figures and diagrams for this reason should be something like the first class citizens of your paper or report, and they should look really, really good, and someone should be able to understand the main parts of your work just by looking at your figures. Unfortunately, what we often see is that students pay a lot of attention on writing their texts and refining it, revising it, which is very, very good, but don't give too much attention to their figures and diagrams. They sometimes look like the students have just spent like 5 minutes for all the figures of their report, which is not good, and which was a motivation for me to prepare this talk. And that's why I also called it. I tried to cover the topic a little bit the other way around. And that's why I called it 5 steps to draw a really bad diagram and how to do it better. So at first we will look at some exemplary data, which is an example from electrical engineering, some data that we want to visualize, that we want to plot. And then we will look at how not to do it. So at the end of this section, we will have a very bad diagram and we will discuss why it's bad and how to improve it. And then we will improve it. So we will look at how to make it better. So at the end of this section, we will have a very, very good diagram. Then we will remember Murphy's law, what can go wrong will go wrong. And so we will discuss some things that can be mocked up afterwards. And at the end or during this section, I will also suggest some software that is very good, in my opinion, to create high quality plots and figures. And then we come to the maybe most interesting and maybe also a little funny section. And I will show you my personal top 5 of the worst figures of recent years that we unfortunately had to see in student reports and papers and theses, and which was, as said, a motivation for me or for us to give you the seminar and to prepare this talk. So let's have a look at the exemplary data. And as said, it's an example from electrical engineering. So let's assume we have a 2-port circuit or 2-terminal circuit, some black box. We want to know what's inside this black box. So we connect some voltage source, sinusoidal voltage source with a certain voltage, and we measure the current that goes into the circuit as a function of the frequency. And we don't have much time. That's why we do this measurement only at 7 frequencies from 2 to 8 kilohertz, and we measure this current. And at this stage or at this position, we could already ask ourselves, is it really necessary to draw a diagram out of this data, because we just have 7 data points, which can also be given quite nicely in this table here. So if we plot it in a diagram, the information density of this diagram will be very, very low. But still, let's say, okay, we want to do it. So how not to plot this diagram? Let's assume we use MATLAB and we have the data for the frequency in a vector called F. We have the data for the current in a vector called I. And then we just plot this. So we get this curve here. And now we think, okay, the problem with this curve is it looks angled. It looks like not really like a step function, but we have these corners here at these points because we just have measured these 7 data points. And everyone will see that we have been lazy and that we did not have much time while we measured only 7 data points. So we want to get a smooth curve. If you don't are familiar with MATLAB, you can do the very same stuff in Excel, a table with the 7 data points, and then you get a curve like this. But again, the problem, now we have these angles because we have just 7 data points. So we want to cover this a little bit, and that's why we smoothed this plot. In MATLAB, there is something like a curve fitting toolbox. Then we could, for example, select the spline interpolation. If you don't know what a spline is, a spline is some kind of polynomial function, and it will be fitted in a way that at these points, not only the value of the function coincides, but also the gradient, also the slope. Yeah, and that's why here's some polynomial and there's some polynomial, and the coefficients are fitted in a way that the function will be smooth at all these points. So we get this smooth function, we delete your original function, and now our function looks smooth. No one will see anymore that we have just measured 7 data points. We could do the very same in Excel. Also, there's something to smooth this plot. No one really knows what happens in the background, only Microsoft knows. But still, again, we would get this kind of smooth function. Okay, so the next step is we would need to get this into our report or into our thesis. And one way that is possible on every computer is you have a button that says print screen. So we copy our screen and we paste it into the favorite picture editing software of our choice, and we crop the figure so that we only have this plot. And now we need to somehow save it to get it into our report or thesis. And we all have our cell phones and cameras, and we know that this JPEG format, by the way, this JPEG, does anyone know what the abbreviation JPEG means? There's also some JEPG, it means joint picture, no, JPEG, joint picture experts group. It was a joint group of experts that developed this compression standard that is well known to compress photos that you do, for example, with your smartphone or with your camera. So now we say, okay, what's good for a photo cannot be so bad for our diagram. So we will save our diagram in this format. And then the diagram looks like this. I will zoom in a little bit so that you can see that it does not really look good anymore, but we don't care. We take this, we paste it into our report. And then we find out, okay, we forgot something. What did we forget? We forgot to label our axis. So we will add these labels later on and say this is the frequency, this is the current, and we give the figure some caption and say, okay, this is the diagram of the measured data. And that's it. That's our diagram. So now we can discuss a little bit what is bad about this. And the first thing that you might say is, okay, the labels have been missing, or we have added these labels afterwards. I will not explain this nice comic here. You can read it yourself. But this explains the situation quite well. So what is all wrong with our diagram here? You can think about this for a little second and maybe stop the video and do some notes. And I will discuss from my opinion what all went wrong. And I tried to group this a little bit into criticism with regard to the content of this figure and with respect to the format. So for the content, as already said, the number of data points is really, really small. So the information density of this figure is small. Is it really necessary to draw a plot for just 7 data points? Why not just give this values in a table? It's a good question. Then this spline interpolation or the smoothing of the curve, it masks this fact. So if you show someone this figure and ask how many points have been measured, people will say, I don't know, 50, 100, a lot, because it's a smooth curve. There are no steps like this. And this effect is also intensified because there are no data points marked. There are no real units given at the axis. The labels have been missing and they have been added afterwards, and so on and so on. And then we can also criticize the figure with respect to the format. Yeah, we have used the raster graphic. I will explain in a minute what this means. We have used this JPEG compression, which is lossy compression, which added this noise around this curve. If you remember when I zoomed into the figure, these compression artifacts that don't look nice. The labels have been added afterwards, and there is no useful adjustment of the font, of the font size, if I go back to this figure. So here the font is really large, these numbers, they are very, very small. Why is the curve blue? Why do we have this stupid gray background here in the background? And so on and so on. So it's just the plain standard setting from MATLAB, why there is no grid, for example. If you want to know, is the value here, the maximum value, above 0.3 or below? Probably below, but it would be much easier to see if we would have a grid, for example. Okay, so now we have a bad plot. Now let's discuss how to make it better. And the first thing that I would like to discuss is the difference between raster graphics and vector graphics. So a raster graphic consists of pixels, and for each pixels it is stored what is the grayscale value or what is the color of this pixel. As an example, I have used here the sign for a bus stop, consisting of, I think, 20 by 20 pixels. And the problem with these raster graphics is if you resize them, especially if you enlarge them, so this is double the size and this is again doubled, or I think it's a triplicate size, so the pixels will grow larger and larger, and you see that this figure really consists of these single pixels. So raster graphics cannot be rescaled without loss of quality, let's say. Another problem is this JPEG compression. As said, it's a lossy compression. You maybe as an engineer, you want to think about what happens in the background, how this JPEG compression works. And what is done is a Fourier transform or a Fourier series, a two-dimensional Fourier series or Fourier transform of this figure is calculated. Yeah, so like this is time and time in this direction, because figure is two-dimensional. We calculate the spectrum, the two-dimensional spectrum of this figure. And then we throw away the high frequencies, and the high frequencies at the end do these sharp transients from white to black to white again and to black and to white and to black and so on and so on. And that's why especially, yeah, and the quality that you save determines how much high frequency information you throw away. And that's why if I zoom in here again, you see that especially at these where we do from white to black to white and so on, we get these compression artifacts. And as said, this JPEG compression was developed for photographs, and in photographs, if you do a photograph, you usually have a smooth transition from something brighter into something darker, or from one color into another, and you don't have this rapid white black white black white black, maybe except if you make a photograph of a zebra. But that's why this JPEG compression works very well for photographs, but it does not work for this type of line art or plots or schematics where you have rapid changes from white into black and to white again. And especially there, these compression artifacts will occur and this noise will occur, which does not look nice. So don't use JPEG compression for such type of figures. Never ever. It's really something of the worst thing that you can do. If you need to use raster graphics for any reason in your report, because maybe you want to save a screenshot from a measurement with some oscilloscope, for example, then please use this PNG compression. PNG stands for Portable Network Graphics, and it's a lossless compression. And it works very well for images that have few colors only, like black and white and maybe red and blue and something like this. It does not work so well for photographs that have a very, very high number of colors. But don't use JPEG compression for line art graphics, for diagrams, for plots, for schematics with few colors only. Okay, and on the other hand, we have vector graphics. And a vector graphic consists, let's say, of basic geometrical elements. So for example, to create this bus stop sign, we would need to have a yellow circle, and on top of this yellow circle, we would need to have a green ring, and then we would have to have three green rectangles. And because this figure now consists of this basic geometric elements, we can arbitrarily resize it or rescale it. Make it larger, and you can see I can zoom in here. We could zoom in infinitely and we would never see single pixels, which is very nice for figures like plot schematics and so on that we want to create. Of course, these figures need to be transformed into another. So if we transform a vector graphic into a raster graphic, it's called rasterization. This is what we do, let's say, all the time if we show a vector graphic on a screen like this, because your screen and my screen here is a raster screen, consists of single pixels. Also, if you print the vector graphic, it will convert it into a raster graphic before printing by an algorithm called rasterization, which is quite simple. The other way around, transform a raster graphic into a vector graphic, it's called vectorization. It's a bit more difficult, as you might imagine, but there are some powerful tools to do it. For example, this PodTrace. It's an open source software that is also implemented, for example, in Inkscape, if you know the software, a vector graphic editing program. And there's some example here just from their webpage. So this is some original image. It's clearly a pixel graphic or a raster graphic. And this is the PodTrace output, the vectorized output. And again, I could zoom in here and you will never see pixels because it's a vector graphic. Okay, so we should definitely favor these vector graphics for our diagram. So how to get it? And again, I will use MATLAB here as an example. So I've written down here the MATLAB commands. So we set a certain paper size, we set a certain position of this plot on the paper, and then the important thing is we will save it as PDF. PDF is portable document format, it's a container format, and it can save vector graphics in a very reliable way. If you are more used to the Microsoft Office world, then you would save it not into PDF. PDF is nice for being imported into LaTeX. If you want to use these figures in Microsoft Word, you would use the EMF, Enhanced Meta File, or WMF, Windows Meta File format. They are also vector formats that can be output by MATLAB. So here, because also this presentation is created in LaTeX and I do all my papers and reports and so on in LaTeX, I use this PDF format. And if I zoom in here, as already said, you see no pixels, very good quality all the time because it's a vector graphic. Okay, so now we already have a vector graphic. What to do? We need to label our axis. Say this is the frequency, with the symbol and the proper unit, and the same for the current axis. Then we could maybe add the grid, and then we could say, okay, we make the line a little thicker that it's better visible, change the line width, and then we could look at the number format, or we could say, okay, now the numbers here, and so they're quite small. If you would use this figure for a presentation, people sitting in the first row, they would have no problems in reading this. But if it's a larger room and you're sitting in the last row and you don't have very good eyes like me, then these numbers here, they would be too small for properly reading them. So we enlarge these numbers. And then we see, okay, what happens is that now our 3000 hertz or 3 kilohertz and 5 kilohertz and 7 kilohertz, they are missing because our number format is not really good. Now the numbers are large, but some numbers got lost because we have this redundant triple zeros here everywhere. So it would be much better if we would have the frequency not in hertz but in kilohertz, for example, because then we would just say 2 and 3 and 4. So we rescale our diagram and say this is now in kilohertz, this is maybe in milliampere, which is a bit easier to read. And now I think we have a very good diagram already. Maybe we could label our data points to show this and this and this and this and this and this. This is really, these are really the points where we have done the measurement, and everything in between these lines here, which are very useful for our eye to follow this curve. But we don't really know what happened here. This is just a lucky guess. This is just some linear interpolation. To be honest, we only really know the point here and here and here and there. And that would now be a very good diagram. It's in a good format. It has clear labels. It has good and readable font size, a thick line, marked data points, a grid, and so on. And now the only way to improve this diagram would be to really improve or enhance the information density of this plot by measuring more data points. So for example, take steps of just 10 hertz, and then we would get 601 frequency points, for example, by automating the measurement, or take a measurement instrument that could measure a lot of data points automatically. And so then we could combine this enhanced measurement and our original measurement into a joint diagram. And so now we have two curves, we have a legend, we have a grid, we have a good font size, we have meaningful labels, and we also have a meaningful figure caption that now says it's the measured RMS current at the passive two-terminal circuit as a function of the frequency, and then for different numbers of measurement points. So now if we compare this now very good diagram with our original diagram, it's a little bit like day and night. And we could say, okay, the original diagram, it's a little bit like an optical illusion. It should show us some values, it should show us some data, but to be honest, it more covers this data. If you show this diagram to someone and ask what has been measured there, no one would say that it's just a measurement of 7 data points. But also just from the visual impression, it does not look very good. Still, we see such diagrams quite often. So it's a little bit like an optical illusion, like this. Is it a rabbit? Is it a duck? No one knows. What is this here? What has been measured here? No one knows. And so finally, from our good diagram, I will shortly go back to the good diagram. Here we can now answer the question, what is really inside this two-port circuit? And if we would look at the original curve, we would say it's a resonant circuit, or with a resonance somewhere here. If we look at this final step data, then it's two resonant circuits where the resonant frequencies are very close together. And so this somehow solves the question on what is inside this two-port circuit, two resonant circuits with different parameters for the resistance, inductance, and capacitance. Okay, so last question is, what can be mocked up afterwards? And here I would like to remember, as said at the beginning, to Murphy's law. So you can also maybe stop the video for a second and think about some ideas, what can go wrong, what will go wrong to this very good diagram. And my inspiration for this was very many presentations that I've looked at, and very many papers and reports that I have read. And another inspiration, as said, was this Murphy's law, what can go wrong will go wrong. The little longer version is, if there's more than one possible outcome for a certain job, and one of these outcomes will result in total disaster, then someone will do it exactly in this way. This Murphy's law goes back to some Air Force engineer that was called Murphy, and at the beginning of the Cold War, they were doing very dangerous and also expensive experiments on what acceleration forces the human body could resist. And some unfortunate human being had to sit on a rocket propelled sledge. And there were different sensors connected to the body, I think 16. And these sensors could be connected in two ways. And so unfortunately, one person connected all 16 sensors exactly in the wrong way. So they did this experiment, but at the end, all the data was totally useless because the sensors were connected wrong. And this then made this Murphy guy, this engineer, to state, to define this law. Okay, so what does it mean for our diagram? One example that you see very often in presentations is that people take now this very, very good diagram, which was perfectly scaled to fit on one slide, but put four of these diagrams on one slide. So it's a very good diagram still, but now the font is just too small. Again, if you sit in the last row, you will have big problems in reading the numbers. So if you have a plot where you cannot read the numbers, then you cannot get what does this data mean that is displayed there in this plot. So then it's totally useless to plot to take a look at this diagram. Another thing that happens quite often is people want to show a diagram on a slide, but they also want to show some additional information. So then they rescale this diagram, but take the original diagram that was created to fit the whole slide and now rescale it that it just fits, let's say, half of the slide. And now it looks a little bit like someone took a hammer and said tok, 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 tok on top of this diagram, because all the numbers here, they look a little bit compressed and the font here looks compressed and so on. It was a very nice diagram before, but now it does not look so good anymore. Another example that happens also quite often is, for example, an international student has written a thesis or a report and has, of course, created his figures with English captions and labels and so on. And then someone decides to take this figure and to publish it into a German article. And then you have a German article with German captions, but you have an English diagram. It is a perfectly nice diagram, but it does not fit the language of the article anymore. This is also not very good. The problem is often that, of course, people take some strange programs to create their figures, and then it's very difficult to later on change these labels to the language that you want to have. The next example is a little bit like this, but a little more sophisticated, and you maybe need to take a second to spot the mistake here. It's capital I here for the current and lowercase I here and lowercase f here and capital F here for the frequency. So of course the notation, the symbols in your report and in your figures, they should of course also coincide and match. And if they don't, it's not good. Just from the visual point of view, it's a very nice diagram, but the notation does not fit to the paper or to the report. Again, a problem might be that if you have created this like 5 months ago in a very strange program that you don't have anymore on your computer, you will not be able to change this small f into a capital F, and you might not be able to change this here for another reason. Okay, so the answer for all these problems in most cases is LaTeX. And in LaTeX, you can also create diagrams directly. And in my opinion, if you're able to create a proper diagram in MATLAB, you should also be able to do it in LaTeX. I will give you some example. So this is how LaTeX source code looks like for a figure. There is some environment called TixPicture. Tix is some package in LaTeX that enables you to draw pictures, general pictures, and inside this there's another package called pgfplots, and this gives you an environment called Axis, and Axis will draw a plot. So this is linearly scaled. There's also semi-log x and semi-log y axis and log-log axis for logarithmically scaled plots. But this gives linear scale plot. And so then we can label the axis frequency, symbol f in a certain unit, a y label, and axis borders or axis limits. And then we can add plots from a table, which makes sense if you have a lot of data points, or you can also give the coordinates directly in the LaTeX source if you just have very few numbers of points, for example, the 7. And this LaTeX source will give you this diagram. And what's of course very good here is that what is the basic principle of LaTeX, we separate content from style. So this is the content. It means we have a diagram with certain data and certain labels, but there is no style given here. There is nowhere here is defined what font is used here and which font size, and that the first line is blue and then the second line is green, and that we have a grid, and that we have a certain size of this figure, and so on and so on. This is specified at the central place, and this gives you lots of opportunities because you can just copy a figure from a report that you have written in LaTeX into a presentation that you have created in LaTeX. And if you copy the figure from the report into the presentation, it will automatically change to the font that you use in the presentation, and to the larger font size that you use in the presentation, and to all the other settings that make sense to be used in the presentation. So what we could also do here is, for example, change the width of the figure. Do not change the height, just change the width, and then LaTeX will automatically redraw this diagram. It will not look like someone used a hammer and pushed on top of this diagram. Or stretched it in this direction, because the font still looks good. Also, additional numbers have been added here, and so on and so on. If you would like to change the labels, as said before, change the symbols, change the language, you can just do it in your LaTeX source. You don't have to use additional programs. You don't have to look for your MATLAB files that you have used like half a year ago on a different computer. Also, if you what happens, for example, also quite often is that you write a report or you write a thesis with, let's say, 100 pages, and then your supervisor, your professor decides, oh, this is a very good thesis. Let's print it and send it to my 50 best colleagues, because I think they should read it. But we don't have much money, so we can just print your thesis in black and white. So please, dear student, go and prepare a version of your thesis where all your 50 diagrams are now not in colors anymore, but in black and white. And if you have written your thesis in Microsoft Word, then you have to open 50 diagrams. For 50 diagrams, you have to change this line style and save it again, and you will be busy like 2 days. In LaTeX, it's very, very easy because, as said, we separate content from style. We just change one setting and say we don't want to have colored lines anymore. We just want to have grayscale lines. These line styles here give black and white and grayscale lines. So you just change one setting, one line in your LaTeX source code, and all the diagrams and all over your document will change from colors into black and white. And also, if you, for example, change the font in all your diagrams, automatically the font will change, which works because we separate content and style in LaTeX. So if you want to try it out and give it a try, you can check out our template that we offer. And it's very easy to use in this Overleaf online editor. You don't need to install any additional software on your computer. You can scan this QR code. And I will also print this link that you see here in the comments below this video. So I hope that that was useful and interesting up to now. And as promised at the beginning, we will now have a look at the top 5 of the worst figures of the recent years. And number 5, the 5th place, looks like this. It's a diagram of a bandwidth. And yeah, we could discuss a little bit now what's bad about this figure. It says, the caption says the bandwidth, delta F, source Wikipedia. And we could discuss if Wikipedia is a good source. In my opinion, it is, because most of the stuff that is written in Wikipedia, especially for natural sciences and mathematics and physics and engineering, is very good and has very high quality. And if something is wrong, at least there's a chance that people correct what is wrong. If you take books as source, books also contain errors, because books have been written by humans and humans do errors or do mistakes. But no one will correct this book if it's once printed. But Wikipedia has a chance that errors, mistakes get corrected. What's probably not good is how this source is cited. Yeah, so what page of Wikipedia? The Wikipedia is very, very large. So from which article within Wikipedia this diagram is copied. So what's bad about this diagram? There is no y-axis. What is displayed on the y-axis? And then it says here the bandwidth is delta F, but we don't see this delta F here inside this plot. Probably this is delta F. Delta F then should be something like F2 minus F1. And if this is minus 3 dB, then what is this here? So it's not a very nice diagram. And it's also a raster graphic. If I zoom in, then you see that it consists of the single pixels, and it looks good, of course, at this scaling on the screen, but if you print it, it will look fuzzy and blurry and not that nice. Okay, so fourth place looks like this. What's the problem here? The labels are missing. What is displayed on this axis? Okay, we can see it's in milliseconds. It's probably the time. And this is an ampere, this is the current. But what's really, really horrible about this figure is the black background. If you will print this figure, it will consume lots of ink or lots of toner for no reason. So definitely not a good diagram. And again, if I zoom in, it's a raster graphic and it does not look that nice. So third place looks like this. This is really something that I have seen in a bachelor thesis, I think. Output of fuzzy controller. As you can see, it's just a plain screenshot from the MATLAB window, even including the taskbar. What's quite interesting is that you can check here at the time. Okay, it's quite decent time to work on a thesis. And then it's a raster graphic, of course, and it's in this JPEG compression. So it has lots of these compression artifacts, but no meaningful legend. I mean, we have lots of different lines here in different colors, but there's no explanation what these different lines mean. There's no explanation what these abbreviations here mean. So this is also some kind of figure. You look at this figure and you don't have any clue what this shall mean, and you are more confused than before, and this figure definitely does not help the reader in understanding what the author would try to explain in his report or thesis or whatsoever. Okay, this second place, I think, is from the same direction. It's also a full screenshot, and it's also a little bit distorted because it's compressed in the horizontal direction. And if I zoom in, then you can see that it's also very, very low resolution. So this is probably something like transfer function, but it's very difficult to read the numbers here. And again, what is this figure trying to tell me? It says Simulink model of two area reheat system with BS system. I would have no clue what this means. The only thing that I can see is that there is something here on top that looks quite similar to what is shown here at the bottom. But to be honest, it does not make too much sense for me. And if you want to explain how your whatever two area reheat system means, it's probably not the best idea to just show the Simulink model of it, but to redraw it and to focus on the main parts and how what are the main components of this and how they are connected to each other. But again, this does not help the reader in understanding what you're trying to explain. Okay, and so now we should make a little a little noise for the first place, and the first place looks like this. This is the top of the charts in the worst figures of student reports, papers and theses that I have seen so far. And as you can see, this is really the motivation for me to create this talk, because it's a figure. Also, the author here, the person, unfortunately forgot to label the axes, so the axes have been added later on. And I think the most important problem here is if I zoom in this, it's a raster graphic, it's compressed, but it's so bad, so low resolution, that you are not able to read the numbers. Also here, it's just some pixels. And so if we look at this, I don't have any clue what this shall mean. I just see a curve that goes up and down, but what is this trying to tell me? And as said, this is definitely not a good diagram. It confuses the readers more than it helps to understand the topic. And please, please take care and avoid such plots, such schematics, such diagrams in your paper, in your thesis, in your reports later on in your study. Thank you.